Well, it's a great Sunday. It's a special Sunday. I always enjoy this time of year. And actually, I was kind of thinking about this. I don't think I've actually been up here in this capacity since last graduation Sunday. So there was a time where I used to be up here every Sunday. I would do the announcements, and then we got technological, and we started doing the announcements on the videos. And so my role kind of shifted and changed. And now, I get the chance to get up here a little bit and preach, but we've been bringing special speakers throughout the year. And so honestly, I was thinking it's probably been about a year since I've been up here and preached. And I thought, you know, outside of maybe goofy things where you see me with my head stuck in a Noah's Ark toy, there's probably a lot of people that really don't know me or know much about me anymore. But my name is Rob Wagler. I'm the family ministries pastor here at Brighton Chapel. I've been here, actually this is the end of my 13th school year. I've been here in the capacity as youth pastor for a long time. I started part-time long time ago. I actually went to college to be a secondary education, a high school teacher, business and speech. And not that that didn't work out, it just God changes and moves you and other things happen. And so I ended up here and just kind of helping part-time with the youth, and part-time led to full-time, and life happens and things grow and change, and I came into a full-time role that just kept going and going, and it's expanded and grown. And as of January, I moved from the role of youth pastor to family ministries pastor, kind of overseeing everything. But I've been married to my wife, Tiffany, for almost 11 years. It'll be 11 years in August. And we've got four kids. I've got Arthur and Sophia and Titus and Brielle. And we're in the midst of birthdays, so we're nine and we're nearing eight. My daughter will be eight in a couple weeks, and we've got a five and two. And if you see little guys kind of running around with us, we actually just started fostering about a month ago. And so we've got two little boys with us that stay with us now. So we've got a couple extras running around if you see all these kids with us, and it's normal. Well, I don't know if it's normal, but it's what it is for us right now. But I want to take some time, you know, as we're looking at this series this month of what God's advice is and how we can follow that. I thought a great place to start, and maybe what would be appropriate for this morning as we're talking to the seniors, is you know, looking at what's the foundation of that advice, and why do we listen to God anyways? Now, over the years that I've worked with students and adults and parents and families, you know, I've seen a lot of great things happen. I've seen lives change. I've seen a lot of bad things happen. I've seen poor decisions being made. And there's one thing that I think, especially now as we're in 2016 and moving forward through this year, there's one thing that really has kind of stood out, and I think that causes me maybe the biggest concern for where we are headed as Christians, where our country is headed, and where our young people are headed. And that's what I'm going to focus on a little bit today, is just this one concern that I have, and I'm going to share that with you in just a few minutes. But I want to go to the scripture, and I want to give some background, and I want to cover a passage. So would you go and turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15 with me? And we're going to start right in verse 1. I've been here a long time. Actually, I've been here like 36 years at Brighton Chapel. And this is my graduation Bible that I got when I graduated in 1996. And it's still together, but it's taken some duct tape and a little extra. So, you know, there's some good Bibles that we're giving out to these guys. So hopefully they use them, and hopefully you guys need some duct tape one of these days. So it's a good sign, I think, right? All right. How are we doing? Are we there? All right, we're not going to put the whole passage up on there. It's a lot, and that kind of gets, a little repetitive. So I really want to encourage you to kind of go to your Bible and just read this with me. We're gonna read right through about first 23 verses. So follow along here. Let me read this to you. 1 Samuel 15, starting verse 1. Samuel said to Saul, "I am the one the Lord sent to anoint you king over his people Israel. So listen now to the message from the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they waylaid them as they came up from Egypt. Now go, attack the Amalekites, and totally destroy everything that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men and women, children and infants, cattle, sheep, camels, and donkeys." Now, I want to pause for a second. As a little bit of background, we're going into this passage, and we've got a couple characters or a couple individuals. We've got Samuel, and Samuel was a prophet of Israel. He was the last one before they went into a kingdom period where they started having kings as their lead roles in the nation of Israel. So Samuel is a prophet that anointed their first king, and Saul here is their first king. So we've got Saul, the very first king of Israel. Now, he's an interesting character. There's a lot of background, a lot of story to him, which we're not going to delve a lot into. But the Lord chose him. He was the Lord's anointed to be the first king of Israel. And he had a little bit of a rough path. And he did not always follow the Lord and follow the Lord's direction in his life. And we're going to see some of that in a little bit. But this passage, Samuel has a commandment from the Lord. And he's telling Saul that he needs to go take up his army and go take care of this group of peoples called the Amalekites. The Amalekites are a nation, it's a group of peoples that was near Israel that caused Israel some problems. And one thing that you'll notice, and maybe you caught it, is God's telling Saul to go take up his army, attack the Amalekites, and he's telling him to destroy everything. Not just everything like their goods, their city, and their stuff, but he says, don't spare them, put to death men and women, children, infants, cattle, sheep, camels, and donkeys. And now, this could be a whole different sermon. We're not going to get into this whole, how can God require someone to go kill children and kill women and kill the defenseless and the innocent? It's a good question, and that's not really the focus today. So I'm going to kind of put that whole thought aside. But what I want to give you background on is the fact that God's doing this as retribution for something that happened. It's recorded back in Exodus 17. But it's retribution for something that happened when Moses brought the people of Israel up out of Egypt. Do you remember they were in slavery for a long, long time there? And the people cried out to God. God brought Moses along, and he had Moses lead the people after we got the plagues, and the Egyptians chased them, and the parting of the Red Sea. Well, when they came up out of that and passed the tribulation and the trials of the Egyptians, as they were moving on, one of the first people groups they came into contact with was the Amalekites. And the Amalekites were not a nice people group, and they came up and they attacked them. And it does tell us that the Israelites, they won, and they defeated the Amalekites at that time. But God was not really happy about that situation. And at that time, with Moses, hundreds of years ago, God made a promise to the Israelites and said, the nation of Israel, you are going to wipe out the people of Amalek, the Amalekites, and they will have their day. And now, as we are here with Saul, again, hundreds of years later, we're coming to the fulfillment of that promise that God is going to take care of the Amalekites. Now, God's a faithful God. When he says he's going to do something, he's going to do it. It might take him a while, you know? He's not like, here you go. So this took God a little bit of time, but he has brought the people to a place where he said, this time now, Saul, I want you to go and take care of the people. So as a little bit of background, there's a little bit of a why to what's going on here and why God is telling Saul and the people of Israel to go and to completely destroy the Amalekites. This is not a random, there is a reason, this is an ungodly people, and this is a retribution for an act that they had done against the people of Israel hundreds of years before. Okay? So with that as background, Saul's being told to do something, God expects him to go do it, right? Okay, so now, picking up in verse 4. So Saul summoned the men and mustered them at Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers, 10,000 men from Judah. Saul went to the city of Amalek and set an ambush in the ravine, and he said to the Kenites, this is another people group, go away, leave the Amalekites, so that I do not destroy you along with them, for you showed kindness to all the Israelites when they came up out of Egypt. So the Kenites moved away from the Amalekites. Just kind of a, hey guys, look, we're not after you. If you want to, get out of the way here, you got a chance, get out of the way. Verse 7, then Saul attacked the Amalekites all the way from Havilah to Shur to the east of Egypt. He took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive, and all his people he destroyed, totally destroyed with the sword. But Saul and the army spared Agag and the best of the sheep and cattle, the fat calves and lambs, everything that was good. These they were unwilling to destroy completely, but everything that was despised and weak they totally destroyed. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel. I am grieved that I have made Saul king because he has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions. Samuel was troubled and he cried out to the Lord all that night. Early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul, but he was told Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor and has turned and gone down to Gilgal. When Samuel reached him, Saul said, the Lord bless you. I have carried out the Lord's instructions. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of sheep in my ears? What is this lowing of cattle that I hear? I love, this is just a little aside, but if you read the Bible, there's so much more there. There's, I mean, Can you imagine Samuel here? I mean, just this humor, this what's the right word? Sarcasm. There we go. I couldn't think of it. Yeah, this sarcastic little wit. I've done everything God told me to do. Here you go. Wait, what's this here I hear in my ear? Is that a sheep bleeding? You know, and it's just this little sarcastic kind of, oh, wait a minute. I just think that's kind of funny. All right, so anyway, verse 15. Saul answered, "The soldiers brought them from the Amalekites. They spared the best of the sheep and the cattle to sacrifice to the Lord your God, but we totally destroyed the rest." "Stop," Samuel said to Saul. "Let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night." "Tell me," Saul replied. Samuel said, "Although you were once small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel, and he sent you on a mission, saying, 'Go and completely destroy those wicked people, the Amalekites. Make war on them until you have wiped them out.' Why did you not obey the Lord? Why did you pounce on the plunder and do evil in the eyes of the Lord?" "But I did obey the Lord," Saul said. "I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. The soldiers took the sheep and the cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal." But Samuel replied, "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king." As I said, I've got I have 4 kids, but my daughter, Sophia, I want to tell you about a little habit she has. So she's a great, she follows directions well. She's good. My boys kind of whine a little bit, but Sophia, if you give her a chore, she'll really do it well. And she's a great little mommy. She likes to take care of the younger kids and take care of things. She really likes to clean and do things around the house. But she has this little habit when she does. So as an example, I could tell her, "Hey, Sophia, I want you to, let's clean your room, okay? I want you to work on your room and get your room clean today because there's stuff all over the floors, you know, the shelf's kind of messy, your clothes are all over. So how about let's clean the room today?" So she'll say, "Yeah, all right, I'm going to clean my room." And she goes into her room and I'll leave and go do other things. And then After a little bit, I'll go back in and I'll look at things, and she's still got stuff on the floors and the shelf's still messy, and she's sitting there with maybe a big smile on her face, and her drawers are all open, and her clothes are all sorted. I'll say, "Sophia, what are you doing? You didn't get everything? I got everything clean. Look at this, Dad. I got," and she'll show me her dresser where she's taken the last hour, 2 hours, and she's sorted all of her clothes. And everything in her dresser is all put away and orderly and nice. And she's like, "Dad, look, I cleaned my room. Everything, isn't this awesome?" I'm like, "No, you didn't clean your room. You like, look at your room. It's still a mess. Now your dresser looks nice and the clothes are sorted and that's fantastic. But you just spent 2 hours doing this when I wanted this all done." And in her mind, you know, she's looking at me saying, "I cleaned my room. I've done this." And my wife and I are talking about this, and she pointed out, I think she gets this from me. We were family cleaning day, right? Some Saturday a while back, and we have a TV room, couches, a couple bookshelves and things. So I was going to go pick up the TV room, clean it up a little bit. And I got in there, and some of the books, we had some books like kind of on the floor and out. The kids had pulled out, or I don't know, something. And so I took the books and I started putting them back, and I was like, "Oh, you know, oh, that one's out of order too. You know, there's supposed to be an alphabetical order on this side. And here's, you know, you got nonfiction, and you got fiction. We got different areas of books." So I started pulling them out, and I'm like, "Well, the shelves are kind of dusty." So I started pulling the books off and dusting the shelves. And pretty soon what Tiffany came in to realize was that I had taken all this time to pull all the books off the shelf and wipe the shelf down and resort and alphabetize. And, you know, maybe there's a couple that we just need to get rid of because we need the space. So I had taken all of my time cleaning the TV room to order the books and clean the bookshelf. So she said, "Hey, look, we can't get on Sophia because you know where she's getting this? She's getting this from you." All right, you're right. So now I don't know if this is necessarily like a bad or good thing exactly when we're talking about kids like this, but I gave this, as I was studying and working through this, I gave this a title or a term, okay? So this is. I don't know if I want you to remember it or something this way. I want you to remember the idea, but I'm going to call this self-authoritative obedience, okay? So does that make sense, or is that a little bit too big? No. So self-authoritative obedience. What I mean by that is essentially that you know that you're supposed to be listening to the authority or the person that's telling you what to do. You're okay with that, and you're going to do it. But somewhere along that path of obeying and doing what you've been told to do, you get off track, and you replace the authority's way of thinking and their way of doing things with your own. And it's kind of a, you know, I know I'm supposed to be doing this, but I think it'd be better if I did it this way, so I'm going to go about this way. And the kicker, though, is that as you've done this, you still understand yourself and believe yourself to be in compliance with the authority and what you've been told to do. Basically, that you're okay doing it that way. Now, we deal with parents and children, right? I mean, this is probably something that's not, you know, not unfamiliar to you if you're a parent. You've told a child to go do something, and here's what we're saying is, you've got the kids that you tell to go do something, and they just don't do it, you know? And then you just have to deal with that. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about you tell a kid to go do something, and they go do it part way. You know, go pick up your toys. Well, then they're in there, and two of them get put back in the shelf, and then they're playing. I did. I picked up my toys. No, you didn't. You didn't pick up anything. Look, you had two trucks in the shelf, and all the rest are still on the floor. No, I picked up my toys. Like, no. So as a parent, we understand this, right? We see this. Now, as a boss or an employee or maybe even coworker, I bet you see this too. Maybe you've got somebody who works for you, maybe somebody who works alongside you, where you or the boss tells them to do something, and they go and they take that instruction, and somewhere in the midst of them doing that, it turns into something a little bit different, and they come back and they're like, hey, I got this job you gave me done. But then you go to check it out, or the boss goes to check it out. No, what you did is not, like, it's not bad, but that's not what I told you to do. That's not exactly the way I wanted it and what I expected out of you. But those are situations that we deal with. And they're not great ones because we have to work through them and deal with them. Even worse, though, and this is where my concern, my one thing comes in. We, meaning us as Christians, I'm not necessarily even talking unbelievers, I'm talking those that we've chosen to follow the Lord. We nowadays, maybe more so than any other time, at least what I feel like in this country, we have become self-authoritative in our obedience to God. What do I mean by that? Well, we, again, being the followers of Jesus, we who claim to follow Jesus Christ, so I'm talking to you and to me, okay? This is not just about Saul or Sophia or me. This is about you, me, and the person sitting beside you. We have become self-authoritative in our obedience to God. We take God's words and God's commandments and what it says in the Bible, and we look at it and we say, I know I'm supposed to do it this way, but it seems like it would work out a little bit better this way. Or, you know, I know God said it this way, but I bet what he really meant was. Or, you know he said it this way, but it's 2016. I'm sure if you would take this into consideration and forward the gospel message or forward Jesus' words to our day and age, what he really meant was this. And we think that's okay. We think that we're in compliance with Scripture because this is what God's saying, right? Even though we've kind of twisted a little bit. Now, we have to recognize, too, that it's not just that we do this consciously, you know? And generally, we don't necessarily just sit down and say, you know, I'm reading this Scripture here, and I know God says this, but I think really what God's saying is that we should do it like this. I think that's what it really is saying here. A lot of times, it's an unconscious thing. Like my daughter didn't go into her room going, I know Dad said to clean the room, but I think what he really meant was I need to take my clothes and just reorganize my clothes and put them in their drawers here. I mean, she just went in there and just one thing turned into another and she just started doing, and by the end of it, what she had done was what she had thought was right, and she just worked it out, and there was no conscious thought to it. So what I'm saying is, as Christians, we don't necessarily sit down with our Bibles and go, oh, I think God needs to update this. I think what he means is sometimes we just live out and work out and do this subconsciously, this self-authoritative obedience, right? Now, I've seen over the years a lot of examples of this. You might be out there thinking, oh, I don't do this, or, you know, I'm very strict in the Bible. I think it's word for word. Well, Maybe. Maybe you are. But the thing is I've seen this, as some examples, I've seen this with people in their decisions of who to date. That maybe I can do it. It's okay, I can get, although God says this way, I'm going to do it a little bit this way. I've seen decisions within marriages. I've seen decisions that have ended marriages where God has said certain things and people have twisted and taken things a different way. The way that we sacrifice our work time, or I'm sorry, the way that we sacrifice our family and our church time for work, or even the way that we sacrifice church time for family or for other things. You know, it's easy to rationalize. It's easy to find, well, they schedule stuff. Well, they do. Well, and God wouldn't mind. Well, we still do this, and it's easy to kind of rationalize and put things kind of on a shelf, right? Our media choices, this is something that with young people, and I shouldn't stop at young people because it really carries over to all of us, but it's getting harder and harder to see a lot of value in media, movies and television and music that's out there. And along those lines, it also is getting so much easier to compromise. Well, if there's a little bit of this, well, I just skip over. Well, I fast forward. Well, I don't really watch. Well, it's not really. And then pretty soon, you don't realize even what a little bit is, and you're so far away from what God has told us to do and how we're supposed to guard our hearts. And maybe even the most important or the biggest one that we deal with now is there's these, and again, I don't want to make the sermon about this, but let's call them moral hot-button topics, right? And there's a lot of things that are floating out there, things that are before government, things that are in laws are being evaluated and changed and made and challenged. And again, I'm not going to get into any one issue or anything, but generally, does this sound familiar that we would say, or maybe we've heard, well, God would want people to be happy, right? He would want them to live that way and to have happiness in their life. Show me that in the Bible. I don't know if I've seen a scripture that says God will allow things just to make you happy. But I think that's a common answer, and the scary thing is it's a common answer from our pews. Because again, I'm not talking about non-believers. Non-believers don't adhere to our word and our Bible and God's word. They fall under a different authority because they don't carry an authority like we do. We carry the authority of God. And so what I'm saying is I'm speaking to us as Christians saying, hey, we are taking what God is saying and we are changing and rationalizing and moving and mixing and thinking it's okay. Now, I think we also have to question kind of like, why do we do this? So I'm going to come back to Saul. So if you're still there, hopefully you're still there in 1 Samuel chapter 15. If you didn't catch it, because I know I kind of left Saul off to the side there, but Saul is a great picture of this self-authoritative obedience, right? And I've got 4 points that I think are at the heart of maybe why he's doing it and why we do it, okay? One thing comes out of verse 8 and 9. So look at verse 8 and 9. I'll reread that here. It says, he took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive and all his people. He totally destroyed with the sword. But Saul and the army spared Agag and the best of the sheep and the cattle, the fat calves and lambs. Everything that was good, these they were unwilling to destroy completely. But everything that was despised and weak, they totally destroyed. Okay, the first point is I think God is a very extreme God. He requires extreme action and complete and full submission. We don't like that. We don't understand it. And when we don't understand it, we think maybe there's something wrong with it. It should make sense in order for us to follow and to submit to it. And I think this is a very extreme passage. Like I said earlier, this isn't about God calling the people to go kill the kids, and why would God do that with the children, with the women, with the innocents? That's another sermon, that's another time. But God said to do it, and Saul was to do it completely, and he didn't. And that's an extreme action to go. I can't imagine being a soldier that I'd have to go in and to kill children and to kill babies, and to know that my God called me to do that. I don't even know how to speak to that, but God said to do it. And if we trust God and God's our foundation and he's the base of everything that we trust and believe in, then we do what God has told us to do. And Saul didn't. So I think one thing is that God's an extreme God. He calls us to extreme action and he calls us to submit fully and completely in those extreme actions. And we struggle with that. Number two, I think the thing is, if you look in verse 15, or chapter 15, verse 12, It says, early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul, but he was told, Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor and has turned and gone down to Gilgal. If you contrast this, and you look back at Moses, and you look back at Joshua, and men of the Bible that came prior to Saul, you see that when God did great things in their lives, these men erected monuments and stones, and they caused the people to come and to worship God and point the glory towards God. Here, Saul is taking this moment and saying, look what we've done. I'm going to make a big statue to myself. And I think that's the second thing, is I think sometimes we twist and change what God has said and what his challenge is to us because we want the glory. We as the creation want the glory and we take it away from the creator. The third thing, if you look in verse 13, when Samuel reached him, Saul said, the Lord bless you. I have carried out the Lord's instructions. To me, it's pretty humorous. Obviously, he didn't. But that's the first thing. He comes right out to him and says, hey, look, I've carried out the Lord's instruction. I've done everything I've been asked to do. No, you didn't. But I really think he believed that. I think he did. I think Saul believed that he did what God told him to do. And I think that's because, and again, this is, we didn't study all of Saul's past and everything leading up to this, but Saul at this point had distanced himself quite a bit from God. He and God were kind of struggling in their relationship and where they were at. And I believe because of that distance, Saul was so twisted and broken that he was off in his relationship that he really truly didn't understand what God was asking of him, and he really truly did think that he was doing what God asked him to do. And I think that's a scary thing for us because we easily can distance ourselves from God. When you distance yourself from God, you get off track. And you misunderstand what God tells us to do because you're not up on it. I'm a married man, and I have a great relationship with my wife, and there's times where she tells me to do stuff, and I misunderstand it, and I don't do it right. And we have a good relationship. We communicate well. And I think if you're a husband, you can probably nod your head along with me that you've done that, right? So in a great relationship, sometimes it's hard to understand and to get everything right. But when you're broken, when you're missing, when you're not in communication in that relationship, it's very easy to misunderstand, to get off, to think you're doing what you should be doing when you're not doing what you should be doing. And I think that's where Saul was. I think he really, truly didn't understand what God was asking. I think he was really just off. And lastly, I think this kind of adds to it, but if you skip down to 20 and 21, Saul is challenging Samuel a little bit. He says, but I did obey the Lord. Saul said, I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal. Saul is rationalizing this at this point. And I believe what he's doing is saying, I think I know what's better. Obviously, God would want us to sacrifice here. He wouldn't want us to kill everything. He'd want us to offer him a sacrifice to show him glory, right? Which, okay, again, it's kind of funny that he's saying that because what did he do? He went and built a monument to himself, right? So here's an excuse. But I think what Saul is saying here is he's trying to rationalize and he's trying to just excuse it by saying, I think I know better of what God's meaning to say than what he's really saying. Now, church, I think there's a big danger in all this. And I think the big danger, if you look at verse 23, okay, we're going to skip again a little more. Samuel replies to him. It says, now, and 22 is the one that you probably thought I was going to go to, and that's a little bit more popular in terms of our understanding of this passage. But 23 is what I want you to look at. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Now, I think there's a lot of danger in this, okay? What God, Samuel, is saying, what he's saying is, this, what you're doing, Saul, is rebellion. This is on par. This is like divination. Divination is essentially, I looked it up, it says seeking knowledge of the future of the unknown by supernatural means. Not God's supernatural means, but other supernatural means, which God over and over and over and over in Scripture says, this is a no-no, do not do this kind of thing. But he's putting this again, my term is this self, I forgot my term, authoritating, the self-authoritative obedience, he's putting this on the same level with divination and with idolatry. And idolatry, a really simple way to look at what idolatry is essentially putting something above God. The crazy thing here is that Saul's putting himself above God. This type of obedience and what Saul's doing here and what we are doing and what the fear of where we are headed in our Christian walk is that we are changing and we're not idolizing stuff or things or even other people, but we're putting ourselves and our own thought process and our own desire above God and God's word and his instruction for us. And guys, I see this over and over and over. I see this with our youth and our young people, and I see this with not so young people. We are very open to this type of obedience and thinking nowadays. And it's a scary, scary thing. And it's a scary thing because what happened to Saul? God said, I'm done with you. The end of that verse, Samuel said, God has rejected you. The Lord's rejected you as king. And later on, the Lord tells him that he even takes his spirit, or Samuel tells him that he takes his spirit away from Saul. And Saul becomes a broken, horrible man the rest of his life. Just his life is crazy and all over the place. But the Lord removes his blessing, removes his spirit from Saul. Now, there's a couple other passages. And Jeff, you'd put up Isaiah 14. This is probably a pretty familiar one. It says, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. Actually, I'll go ahead. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to the grave, to the depths of the pit. Now we know who this is talking about. This is talking about Satan, right? This is probably the first moment of pride coming in. And essentially, it's a sin of idolatry where Satan's putting himself above God and says, I'm going to be greater. I'm going to do what I want to do, and I'm going to be greater than what you are. And there's a great fear I have, which I think is echoed, or maybe I echo it, coming out of Matthew 7. So one more scripture here. Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Jesus is doing some teaching. He's explaining some things to his disciples and some followers. Jesus says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. I think it's a very, very stern warning that I think we should take very, very cautiously today. I want to be careful to say, you know, and to challenge where our standing is in our relationship with the Lord, but, you know, over the years, one of the biggest things that I teach with the youth group is that we always have to be evaluating where our heart is and where our relationship with the Lord is. And in doing so, we need to look at how we're living our lives. Because it's very easy up here, or even in here, to think I'm good, and I'm fine, and I'm right on par with the Lord and what he wants. But the reality is we need to take our actions and measure them against the words in this Bible. And we need to say, are we doing and acting and saying what's in accordance to his word? And are we really living out what God's called us to live out? And the thing is that's hard. That's uncomfortable. It's sometimes extreme. And it sometimes takes some initiative to learn and read and understand exactly what we're to be doing and how we are to go about it and do it. And we tell the kids, or I tell the kids, one thing that we've talked about over the years, I think if you really evaluate, you look at your life, and there's two things that the Bible is very clear, is that if you're leading a life that you're following Jesus, then you should have two things in your life. You should have persecution, because the Bible seems very clear that when you're following Jesus Christ, you will be persecuted. You will have trials, you will have tribulations in your life. So I tell our young people, I say, are you being persecuted? Do you find trials in your life? And if you don't, you should probably ask yourself what you're doing. And you should have fruit. Now, we're not Billy Graham, you know. Not everybody's meant to be on stage leading people to come and bow their knee to the Lord. Some are. But the Lord calls us to have fruit in our lives. We should be changing lives, and we should be the tool that God uses to see lives changed. And we tell the youth kids, we say, look, if you don't have fruit in your life and you can't think, oh, I know that somebody's different because I've been involved in their lives, and if you don't have persecution in your life coming from it, you know, from somewhere, I would really question if you're following the Lord and truly doing what you're supposed to be doing. Now, here's the thing. I think there's three things to close on. If you think you're off, if you're not really, if you don't see those things in your life, if you don't know if you're following the Lord and you want to redirect that, I think number one is you got to be willing to be extreme. In our culture, in our society, you're really being called, believers and followers of Jesus Christ, you're really being called to be extreme today. You are. You're called to step out, stand up, and be counted. The second thing is you got to fully submit. As a believer in Jesus Christ, there's no halfway. You're all in or you're all out. And I think that's what Matthew tells us. If you say it, you're just speaking it with your lips. It's got to be lived out. And I think the third thing is we've got to be up on God's word, and you've got to be sure of what he says. And the only way you do that is you spend time with him. And you spend time here, and you spend time there in Sunday school, and you spend time talking as a family and as friends, and you communicate, and you work through, and you discuss, and you study, and you learn, and you grow. But it's very, very possible. And one of the things, again, you know, just kind of closing this out, one of the things that seems to come up over and over and over with our youth and any Sunday school, anything I teach, the challenge is, and what I tell people, God wants so much for you and for your life. And when you're willing to be extreme and to submit and to understand and learn and work for what he's trying to give you, he will bless you. He will give you fulfillment in your life. Now, I'm not talking he's going to give you money, he's going to give you cars, he's going to give you the right wife or the right husband or a perfect relationship or X or Y or Z. What I'm saying is he's going to give you a peace and he's going to give you fulfillment. And what you're going to find through him is greater than anything else that you can find when you choose to do it your own way and make your own decisions. And that is so hard to understand. We get it, and we hear it, and we get it, but living it and working it out there, oh, it's so hard. It is so hard. And so seniors, you know, for you guys heading off to work, heading off to college, heading off to whatever your future has, there's relationships in store for you, there's careers, there's great things. And my challenge for you and for everybody in here is go after it. Go after what God has for you first and foremost. And everything else, you know, the Lord says it'll be added on that. And again, I'm not saying money and jobs and whatever else that you want. I'm saying God will take care of you and you'll have nothing like the fulfillment and the joy that God is going to give you when you surrender, when you go extreme, when you learn what he has in store for you. So go after that. Don't fall into this half-hearted obedience thinking, oh, I know what's right and what I'm going to do. Go after what God has for you, and hopefully in a few years we'll see you, you know, just living this strong, awesome life for the Lord. And that doesn't just stop with the seniors. Some background. Hey, I feel like I was in Star Wars for a second. But anyway, that doesn't go just for the seniors. That's for all of us. So let's pray and close, and we'll get everybody out of here. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for this morning. We just pray that you just allow us to take these words to heart, Lord. They're not my words. Lord, this is your challenge, your commandment, and your scripture that's speaking these things to us. Lord, help us to take it to heart, to recognize that we're not the ones that are dictating life, but Lord, you are. You're the one leading. You're the one directing us. And may we just submit and go all out for you, Heavenly Father, Lord. We thank you for this day, and I pray again, just a blessing over these young people's lives as they move into this next chapter of their lives. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. You are dismissed. Thank you.